And see if you can come in now.
Still asking for a passcode.
All right, other people are coming in. That's really weird. You shouldn't have that problem at all.
I think it might be because I was signed into my Zoom or something.
Okay,
But
so
can
sign
you
out
just
of
read it to
yours.
me? Because I saw what it was M or something.
I didn't hear the
I
last
just
thing you
looked at the
said.
passcode. Could you just read me the passcode? I saw it was M something.
Read you the passcode. Okay,
What do you
passcode
mean?
M327K3. Shall I read that again?
No, I got it. Let's. Okay. Yeah, that seemed to work. Perfect.
Okay, let's see if you're here. Colin, Miri, Sheva. Okay, Miri is here. Miri is being admitted. Colin Moss, Wendy, and away we go. All right, she seems to be in.
Okay.
And
You have to let me in.
I did.
Okay.
Okay, great. All right. Can you say a few words there, please? Sheva Chaya?
I'm muted. Hi.
No, you sound fine. You're not muted. It's all good.
Okay. I just need a second to attach this because it fell off. One
Sure.
second.
Hey, Colin, great to see you back. Wendy, yourself? We are just getting last minutes in the artist studio. And just for the few people who have just come in, oh, we have six people already. How about that? And let me open it up for anybody else that's coming in. Who is on iPad? I do not know. Ruthie Eastman. Ruthie. All right, Ruthie. Okay. Sheva Chaya. I'm going to introduce the show and talk you in while you set up your gear. Can you speak from back there? We'd like to hear you. A sound check. Yeah, you speak up just a little bit because you are far away from the speaker. Just speak a little bit louder, like you're working the back of the room. For those out there who are just coming in, hey, okay, all the cool kids are here early at the pool party. All righty. So I will welcome everybody who's coming in and joining the show. Our guest, our very special guest this evening is Sheva Chaya from originally from Colorado, I believe, and she is a very accomplished artisan and glassblower in Tzfat. And she has a gallery, as you can see around her, and she's used to doing this with a lot of groups and people where the camera would be going back several rows for her work. And we will put a link in the comments for Sheva Chaya's studio. As you know, everybody in Tzfat and the north of Israel is struggling mightily during this war, economically and socially and psychologically. And Sheva Chaya has still, through it all, been doing her glassblowing work, which is, to me, it's like molten magic. And I mean, it's just phenomenal to watch. And we've been friends for a long time. She does a lot of work with women's groups in Tzfat. Wrote a what's the word I'm looking for the Purim, the Purim Megillah, the Megillat Esther for Purim, the Purim scroll. She wrote one with a lot of people. Molten magic, right? That's the word. Okay, Belle is here. Okay, great. So we got a nice crowd going. Sheva Chaya is getting her gear together and going to get fired up. I don't know what she's going to do, and this is really freestyle here. Adele is at an event and she was unable to attend. Hopefully, many more will be here. And for everybody who's come on, I thank you so much for your patience and your interest and your support. And it's very, very highly appreciated by all of us on this end. And of course, Sheva Chaya has her studio and she does stuff online with groups She has her various social media where she advertises and shares her wisdom and her artistry. And it's really some pretty cool stuff. I don't know nothing about this. So I'm going to pass it over to Sheva Chaya and say hi. There is down below in the description a little bit of her history. But you can bring in whatever you'd like right now. And we're all here. Sheva Chaya.
Okay. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it. And hello, shalom to everyone joining now and wherever it might be. From Tzfat, from the heart of the old city of Tzfat, the artist's quarter. I'm all set up now in front of my workspace, so I'll show you this space for now, but maybe in a few minutes I'll do a little walk around the gallery so you can get a little taste of the bigger space. I'll just tell you my 2-minute life story. I grew up in Denver, Colorado. I had no dreams to come to Israel, live in Tzfat. I never heard of Tzfat growing up. I grew up Jewish, but I didn't get much content. And the first time I came to Israel, I was 17. I came on a teen tour out of Denver, and I came to Israel. No expectations, and I was basically amazed by Israel. Israel.
Israel seemed to be the tiniest place ever with the most happening ever. It still does. I think it always will. It was a very intriguing place because it seemed to be a little tiny dot on the map with everything in it. And growing up in Colorado, I had, the experience of driving all day long, 8 hours, 12 hours, 14 hours, still the Rocky Mountains, still very beautiful, but a lot of the same view. And here, drive 20 minutes, 15, 20 minutes, and it's a whole new ecosystem. It's a whole new scene, a whole new feeling, a whole new set of colors. And I was immediately fell in love with that and wanted more of it and wanted to learn more about it and be a part of that more, get involved more. So I came back, and every time I came back, I kept having more good reasons to come back to Israel. And it keeps happening. And this is the same period of time I was getting into art. So I got into art in college. I went to Princeton, majored in art and art history with a focus in painting. I started with oil paintings and then went into watercolor paintings. You see some paintings around the gallery. And I get to say a big mazel tov actually this year, even though everything has been totally different since October 7th and this war started. The normal scene here, which is never really normal, but we were used to, is people coming from all over the world, visiting the gallery full of children, parents, communities, amazing flow of people usually. So this year it's been completely quiet, no visitors. And here and there, but you know, I thought I knew what quiet was before, but this is a whole new level, way worse than Corona, because in Corona, at least Israelis were traveling and wanting to visit everywhere. And I got to meet all kinds of people from Tel Aviv during Corona, but this year, nobody's coming. Everyone got the message, it's dangerous to come to the northern border. Tzfat is a northern border town. And so what does one do? You know, I have this gallery, I have this space, and some very interesting different types of things have come through this year for me that I get to actually say a couple of mazel tovs. It's actually very exciting. One being that my a classic painting of mine, the Noah's Ark, is now, just now, become on display in the Bible Museum of Natural History in Beit Shemesh, which is a super exciting accomplishment that actually one of my paintings is in a museum. This is a first. So mazel tov on that, big l'chaim. And another very special aspect, and maybe I can, you know, we can share later on the group, some pictures of it, but in Tzfat, there's new light show. I don't know if anyone has seen the light show in Yerushalayim or in other places where they, you know, on the building, on the side of a building, display a beautiful light show of different types of things, history, artwork, different types of pieces. So Tzfat actually came out this year with a light show shown on what's known as the Wolfson Tower, the clock tower in the center of town.
It's an Ottoman era stable, actually, that was used by the British and had various uses over the years. And now it's a cultural center and synagogue. And we'll put a picture of that up here in the notes below in the comments. Please go on.
Yeah, and if anyone jumps onto my Facebook, I'm on the Facebook, I'm called the Glassblower Tzfat, because one of the things that happened this year, I was called Sheva Chaya on Facebook until this war broke out, and then on the internet level of the war, some not so friendly cousins were decided to take down my Facebook account and fill it with I don't even want to say it, but free Palestine, whatever type of messages, and totally overtook it. So I had no access to my 5,000 friends I had built over the past 15 years on Facebook. So what am I going to do? You know, so I started a new account called the Glassblower of Tzfat. So you can, I think it's posted in the comments already.
Yes,
if you look
is.
There, the profile picture background is a picture of the Wolfson Tower, this building, with my paintings, or this amazing new different types of things coming through this year. My painting, I was one of the featured artists on the light show, and one of the featured, you know, present day artists. Quite a few of them are actually, you know, historical artists that were part of the artist colony of the earlier generation in Tzfat. A big, big honor. So the picture there is with one of my paintings. I'll actually show you the painting right now. And then I want to show you the glass blowing.
Yes. We are all looking forward to the glass blowing.
So this is a painting that you will see on that background picture. That's actually amazingly it's the shape of this building with towers and a clock tower. It's a very cool thing. So check that out. It was a very exciting accomplishment for me that happened. And I'm going to start now. I'll make a piece. I'll make a glass piece. And yes, a flute player, exactly. Perfect for you, Miri. It all comes together. So what I normally do, and I'll welcome you into the gallery like I would normally welcome people into the gallery, show people a glass piece being made live. So I'm going to do that now. And while doing so, I'll explain a little bit what I'm doing and a little bit about the glass artwork. And this will actually show you the process of one piece being made. There's types of pieces that I still do have available. I have available in the gallery. I can show you a walk around hopefully by the end. And so if anyone's interested, we ship worldwide, all of these aspects are still available. So let's start. The raw materials that we're starting with are a tube. This is a glass piece. It's a tube, open tube with a thinner end. The thinner end the end right now is closed. I'll open it up and I'll close one end, open the other, and I'll blow through the open end to make the shape. I also use solid sticks of glass, such as this and this, different colors, blue and white there appropriately, covered Eretz Yisrael, our homeland. And I also use broken glass, shards of glass. So I have crushed glass here. And I'm gonna use a little bit of all these different forms of glass to share with you the making of a piece. And in doing so, you'll see not only the process of a glass piece being made, but also learn on a lot of different levels, which I'll share with you. And hopefully the sound will work for that to be the case through the work as well. I don't know if you've seen glass blowing before or not live, but this is a very hot flame. I work with a fire which it goes above 5,000 degrees Fahrenheit. The glass goes to about 2,400 degrees Fahrenheit. Super hot. That's like, you know, more than 10 times hot as hot as we would use an oven, even to cook something on a higher temperature. So I put the glass into that very hot flame and it heats up. Right now, I'm just opening the end of the tube. I dipped the hot glass in water. So now, I don't know if you can actually see that, but there's an open end of the tube there. And I'll fire polish the the end of the tube. So now it's a smooth piece. It was just broken all around the edge. And now I put the fire on that open edge, that broken edge, and melted it. So now it's a smooth, unbroken edge. And now I went back to the other side to heat up that side to close the other end of the tube. So while this is heating up, this takes a moment. I'll give you a bit more of my background and how, what I would consider the, what I would call the Torah of glass kind of came to be. This, what I end up sharing in the gallery is actually a lot of different levels of what we can appreciate about glass. Yes, it's a beautiful material. It's an interesting material. And we also have it sourced in our spiritual sources, including the source of the sages and tzaddikim that live right in this area where we are now in Tzfat and near Meron, in the Zohar Kodesh, the Book of Illumination, where Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai teaches us not only about you know, how things work in the world, but the deeper inner spiritual workings of reality. So actually glass is mentioned in these sources. So I'm going to share with you a little bit about that as well. Well, basically, catching up on the story. So when I first got a little taste of Israel, I was amazed and wanted more of it, like I mentioned. And I was in the middle of college and I wanted to graduate. I wanted to be responsible and get my degree from Princeton and go back and finish. So I went back for my senior year, the whole time wanting to come back to Israel. You see the glass now is glowing. I hope you can see that. Wanting to come back to Israel and planning on it and finishing my senior year, doing an art show where I was for the first time learning Hebrew. I never learned Hebrew growing up. The extent of my Jewish education was more lox and bagels level, not learning the language or sources. I started to learn Hebrew. What I'm doing now is closing up the end of the tomb. So where it's hot, it's sticky. See that glowing glass? And then I just close it up with this tool. So now it's a closed vessel, a closed tomb. So when I came to Israel, I was really amazed because I had no idea that we had such a deep and rich tradition where you can learn so much on so many levels and live it, you know, having grown up in a environment of highest level of education in the Western world, going to Princeton University, one of the best Ivy League schools out there. I was surprised and amazed to find that what I could learn in the living room of a Rebbetzin in Jerusalem was way beyond anything I learned at Princeton, because the learning is applicable to life and meaningful and not just, you know, what they call like ivory tower type of information. So I was very intrigued and amazed and drawn to learning in that direction. I have been ever since I started, and honestly, just more and more as I pick up the language and learn more about the tradition, how it all fits together. It just becomes more and more amazing and interesting with time. So when I first came on the scene, you see the glass here is nice and glowing and hot. Where it's hot, it's also sticky. So I'm gonna roll that hot glass in some broken pieces. I don't know if you see those little dots on there. It looks like little shards of glass on the glass. Basically, the hot glass picks up some shards of broken glass. And now I put the glass back in the fire and the fire melts the glass in. So I started asking around when I came to Israel. I noticed the Torah talks about everything. It talks about every subject you could imagine, everything in life, from waking up in the morning to how you tie your shoes. Amazing detail. And I got the idea. It talks about every subject you could imagine. So I started to ask around, so what does it say about glass? Because that's my interest. And I didn't get any quick answers. Nobody had any quick answer, but I continued to ask and search. Eventually, I found some young yeshiva bacharim who were willing and happy to search for glass for me in the sources. And this was back in the day before Rabbi Google and Chabad.org and Safaria and such easy ways to look everything up. In a split second, anyone could look up anything and everything you could imagine. You had to actually look in the books, the concordance, right? The gigantic, thick books of concordance. You look up a word and see everywhere where it was, to actually look up the books and find the pages. Wait, I can't see the whole question. Can you either unmute and can someone read it to me?
Sure. A couple of questions here. Do you make the stems or get them elsewhere?
So the raw materials I buy are tubes, rods, and powders of glass.
And do you buy that from abroad, or is that something that's available locally?
I mean, it's all imported. Anything I get in Israel is already imported. And in terms of the colors, like what I'm using now, I'm taking a stick of glass, which I pour really thin, so it's like sharpening the pencil, if the glass is a pencil. Mm-hmm. Glass, both the canvas and the paint, right? So that very thin glass, these sticks of glass, I prefer to buy them myself because I can get all kinds of amazing colors that are available not here. And what is available here is... it's both limited and it's very expensive.
quick question.
It's expensive everywhere.
How does rolling the hot glass in the tiny shards of glass and then putting it back into the fire make it less sticky? Did you hear the question?
So basically it doesn't make it less sticky. The glass, where the glass is glowing and hot, where the glass is glowing, it's hottest. And if it's hot enough, it's sticky. So what I do in order to see, now we have little white dots. So those dots weren't there before. There are shards of glass on the table that are white. So when the glass is hot enough, when I get it to a really glowing orange, it's hot enough to actually be sticky. And then I roll in the broken pieces, they stick on, and then I put it back in the fire in order to melt those little dots of glass in, those little pieces in. If I don't put it back in the fire, they'll fall off or they'll start a break in the glass because it's a place of contact where it's not melted in well.
It's also two different temperatures, correct?
Yeah, so I'm working with the temperature on the glass, like basically traveling from one side of the glass to the other. So I start heating it up, which is important. It's more the inner workings of how the glass works, but you don't want to jump around, heat it up on one side and jump to the other side. It's a method. It's methodically chosen to start on one end and heat it up towards the other end. It keeps the glass, so to say, happy, not breaking.
While you're doing that, quick question from me. During the course of the war, we've had many, many alerts and attacks, rocket and exploding drone attacks on Tzfat. Has that ever happened when you were in session like this, and has it affected what you were doing? Like you dropped something or glass cracked?
No, actually, the word unfortunately popped to my mind, but unfortunately, I haven't had a lot of opportunities to blow glass this year. I've had a lot of obstacles to actually being able to do it. As much as I love it, you see, I didn't forget how to do it and I still love it. I'll always love it. But the circumstances, the stress of the possibility of there being sirens or missiles and being available for my kids and being just... I don't want to say it's just being in survival mode, but I definitely feel like this year has called upon me and others as well to just be here, to just live here. And me opening up the fire, making glass pieces. So when people come and ask me to do it, I do it. But on my own, when there's a lot of other things to take care of and worry about, so to say, I haven't had so many opportunities. So that hasn't happened yet. I hope it doesn't happen. I hope to blow glass as much as possible and it doesn't happen because we've already taken out the all of the possibilities of anyone trying to make any sirens go off here other than the siren before Shabbos.
There is a siren, just for people who know, to remind people that the Sabbath is coming in for those who are observant. And it's not like the siren for rocket alerts. It's usually with music, in fact, on a recording, just to say, here we go, folks. While you're saying that, while you're doing that, I want to mention that being in the moment when you're doing that, Miri and I can certainly appreciate it, being beekeepers. When we did have rocket alerts and explosions overhead, we were so immersed doing our beekeeping out in the field, we didn't even hear the booms. So I can imagine being at that moment, in the moment, would help to focus, and there's certainly a zen to it, of how it's done, how you heat it, and the exactitude that it must be done all the way around the glass to craft it. I mean, it's just marvelous to watch for all of us, I'm sure.
Yeah, definitely. I definitely, now that we're on this subject, I would say, practically wise, the smartest thing for me to do in this situation as it is, like, you know, they say, be careful, be ready in case, God forbid, there's sirens or bombs, or whatever. So you have food, you have a place to go, the light's on, there's nothing blocking the way, so you can, you know, get there without tripping, et cetera, et cetera. So for me, being the glass blower, add on a few other steps, like have the kiln on and have the door open. So if I do need to go, I could go and stick my hot glass piece in the kiln, so it stays warm, so it won't break while I'm waiting, you know, for the booms to pass, so I can go back to the glass piece.
I said priorities.
Priorities. I mean, you know, glass doors have a little extra to think about because, you know.
What are you making here? What's the finished object? What's your vision?
So I was thinking, I think I'm going to make a cup. I'm going to blow the glass now. So let's actually focus in a little bit. I'll show you what I'm doing a bit more. And then if there's more questions and there's more time, I'm happy to do a walk around the gallery and show you some more pieces. I'm getting to the point of, I'm getting to the point of blowing. The glass, it's called glass blowing, not for no reason. The fire heating up the glass makes it malleable, like we already saw. It's sticky, it's movable, it's changeable. One of the main ways to change the glass is to actually blow into it and change the shape. So I'm heating up the glass, a lot of the glass, in a very strong way, and also hopefully in a very even way, because if the glass isn't heated up evenly, it'll basically blow faster, it'll move faster in the areas that it's heated up more. So I like to, as opposed to saying making the glass plastic, I like to make it, there's plasticity to it, yes, but I prefer to say molten, because the amazing thing that's happening here is it's very clear, direct source of element, which is the fire. The fire actually switches the glass. It brings out the plasticity in glass, but it's molten. So we see now the piece before it's being blown. And I'm spinning it around all the time because I don't know if you guys can catch on there. I wrote something on there in Hebrew. Basically, glass on glass design is one of my specialties. So when the glass is molten, it's movable. And this brings us to another source that I like to share, which is one of the wonders of glass blowing is that the shape is made with the breath. And in any situation of an artisan making a piece, there's tools that they use. The tools are usually in the hand of the craftsman or artist. It's a machine, it's a computer. In this case, the tool is the life force. It's inside the lungs of the person. Can't live without it. There's no way to be even without it. So it's very basic, foundational type of a thing. And this intrigues also our sages. If you're looking back in the sources, going back to the very beginning of humanity, actually, going back to one of the very beginning stories of humanity and understandings we have of reality, the very first person, his name is Adam. Adam in Hebrew is the same root word as Adama, which means earth, dirt, good material, lots of potential, but nothing happened yet. And then it says this little puff of air is blown into Adam and he came to life. And our sages say, why does it say a puff of air is blown into him? It doesn't say it's his birthday he was born. It says a puff of air is blown into him. So they think about it and they say, and they give us the answer. The best way to understand this, to contemplate this, is to look at and see glass blowing. And when you see glass blowing, why? Because you have an opportunity to see this process of a vessel, a shape being blown into and the shape being made. The closest thing we have to life, the neshama is the soul, is like the breath, neshama is almost the exact same word with just different vowels. The soul is like the breath is the soul. So the breath blowing into the glass is a way for gives us a way to understand something very, very deep beyond just this nice vessel. Air goes in, pushing out the glass, making the shape. So the shape changed a little bit there. It's like a light bulb thing. Okay. Got a little movement because the glass is hot and I'm spinning all the time to make the glass move. And now I'll change the axis and finish up the cup. So while I'm in explaining mode here, and then I'm happy to go back to questions. It's hard for me to read questions while doing this because I have to look at what I'm doing. But the I'll share with you another idea. I noticed after doing this many times, that we have a glass in a very special life moment. We break a glass, as we know. We break a glass under the chuppah, right? When a couple gets married, traditionally, a glass is broken under the chuppah. And this is a tradition that if you ask any school child learning about it, why do we do that? What's that all about, that we're breaking a glass under the chuppah when a couple gets married? They say it's because of the Beit HaMikdash, right? The wedding canopy, the Beit HaMikdash, the temple in Jerusalem was destroyed. And we break the glass in this very happy moment because we say in that moment of breaking the glass, Im eshkachech Yerushalayim tishkach yemini. In such a happy moment, such as a couple getting married, one of the happiest type of moments there are, we break a glass. Why? Because we force ourselves and choose to remember in our happiest moments, as happy as we might be, we're not there yet. The world still has brokenness. As long as there's still brokenness in the world, we need to recognize that and think of what is the ultimate symbol and understanding of brokenness is that the temple, the house for Hashem, for God in the world, is destroyed, is broken. There's not that place of indwelling in the center of the world, in the heart of Yerushalayim in Jerusalem. If that's not there, no matter how happy we might be, we're still not there yet. There's more happiness. We want to get all the way there. So we break a glass, remembering Yerushalayim in this moment, to remember the brokenness and to hope and pray for the wholeness to come, because it's on its way. So I realized I could make a glass to be broken under the chuppah in that moment, but I wouldn't just want to make a glass to be broken. The broken pieces are saved and sent back to me, and I connect them, like I showed you before, the broken pieces melting into the sticky glass to a new piece of glass and make that into a gift, which I send to the couple after the wedding. So I'm jumping to, because it's fast speed here, because you can't choose timing with glass blowing. You just have to do everything in the moment that you have to do it. So now I'm going to open up the glass. Watch carefully. I made the shape, and now I want to take off the handle. Watch carefully. On purpose, popping the bubble in the fire in order to cut off the handle. By popping the bubble, it basically makes a cut, and then I melt around it, and then I can clean off the end to take off that handle and basically cut the glass with the breath. So the breath, like we were speaking about before, we notice the breath when a baby is born. And when a baby is born, it's like we were saying before, a person, a human being is Adam, Adama, coming from the material. That's the material, the earth. And how does it actually happen that the person comes to life? It says, Hashem napacha pav nishmat chaim. The life is blown into us. Truthfully, actually, every single time we breathe, the whole time we're alive, our entire lives, it's happening. We're being blown into that breath. And if it's a good thing to stop and think about, we take a deep breath with gratitude, with presence, then we're tapping into this beginning connection place, which is very important. It's very important to do it all the time. So glass blowing reminds us of that, and a new baby being born reminds us of that, because it's so amazing when a baby's born. We notice the breath, and then we go about life. A person doesn't their whole life go about saying, oh, another breath, that was a great one. I'm about to breathe. Here comes another one. Can't wait for the next breath. I think these breaths are so amazing. No, unfortunately, we don't realize we should do something more like that, because when we're recognizing every single breath, then we're connecting to our source. We're connecting to our beginning. and consciousness, a higher consciousness level. So since we don't notice it, we need ways to remember. Babies being born, we notice for that moment. And glass blowing reminds us of it. Because when you see a little person like me, Sheva Chaya, senior in Tzfat, blowing into a glass piece, you might not think that a little puff coming out of a little person like me could open up glass. But we saw it happen. It's surprising. And as our sages, like I mentioned before, our sages noticed this is the best way to understand glass blowing, the best way to understand this breath being of life being blown into Adam, the beginning of life, that connection, that place of being so close to the source. Through
just
what?
Warning,
through the breath.
We have 4.5 minutes left. Time
okay.
check.
So I'm just finishing up this piece. Just spinning out the top of the glass. We're getting more towards the shape of a glass here.
While you're doing that, I'll read off a question. Are your kids fascinated with your art? Surely at least the fire. Any chance any of them will follow in your footsteps? By the way, the spiritual way you approach your art makes it feel even more beautiful.
Thank you. It depends on the age of my kids. I'm mostly in like teenager phase. So teenagers are cute. They're very special.
Cute.
Yeah, how interested
cute.
They are in interesting things is can be possibly up in the air for the moment. But their interest is it comes and it goes and it comes and it goes. And I think that it sinks into my kids. It's slowly sinking into their experience and mind that there's something very interesting going on here. How much they can look at it and focus on it and get involved with it is each one in their own pace and the right time. I'm not pushing anyone to be a glass blowing fanatic of my children. If they find it interesting, I'm here for it. And I think they know that. So I want to just finish this up. And since we only have a moment left to just at least open up the camera and walk you around the gallery for just even a minute.
Exactly.
So you can
see
the space.
3 minutes.
So 3 minutes is great.
Okay. And it stops dead, by the way. I can't turn it on and off. It stops.
No worries. No worries.
You want to walk around?
Okay, so here's our little cup. Still glowing. And this is available if somebody wants this as a gift or someone might be looking to support artists in Israel. You can definitely be in touch and I can get that out to really anywhere in the world. So let me just walk you around the gallery a little bit. This is a Tree of Life picture. And I also make glass pomegranates. So these are examples of the glass pomegranates. Here are some books.
You see the gallery is in this old house here in Tzfat, and it's a really amazing space. There's a lot of soul there. You can feel it when you go in there.
Yeah, everyone's invited. Please come when you can. This is the wedding glass I spoke of, the glass, the broken pieces, and the gift. So the gift has little blue dots on it. Those are the same color as the original cup that is broken under the chuppah because I melt them in and then make a gift based on that. I have some really beautiful artwork here, some work of the maestro Johnny Toso, one of my mentors and teachers and inspiration, some of my own work here. And everything's available. I pack things well. I ship all over the world. Thank God I've had a lot of support all of the time. And this year it's been extra quiet. So if anyone has any interest in getting some artwork,
I think we've got 1 minute left. And any last questions before we go for Sheva Chaya?
Welcome to also in touch, email. Yeah.
I will put in links to everything that's on the chat on this program when we put it up on the page. Thank you so much for being with us on Life on the Border. And thank you, Sheva Chaya from Tzfat, and everybody for your questions and your interest. Thank you very, very much. Everybody take care. Have a safe, quiet
shalom.
Week.
Shalom, shalom.